of the video series of the fundamentals of machine design. In the previous lectures, we have seen different parameters which can create the stresses in the working condition of the component. And from this lecture, we will discuss about the introduction of the stresses and different definitions related to them. First of all, let us define the stress by a particular example. And for an example, we have considered a body which is fixed at one end and which is subjected to an externally applied force P. As you can see, the force is applied horizontally, and which can be represented in this diagram like this. And if we want to break down or draw another equivalent diagram of this particular phenomena, then we can draw it another way. That is, the body is fixed at one end, and that's why whenever we apply an external force P on the body, it will create a reaction in the opposite direction, and that reaction will be equal to the exactly the value of the externally applied force. That is nothing but the P. So the body can be equally represented by the externally applied horizontal right side direction force and the force which was generated as a reaction having the same value of the P. So there will be the two different forces. One is horizontally right side and another is the left side. These two forces will create the stress in the body, and that's why we will break down that particular phenomena at the particular section. So consider a vertical cross section at the middle of the body, and if you consider two different points at that particular section, that will be A and B point, and at this particular points we will discuss about the effect of different forces. Now if you consider the externally applied forces, those two forces having the nature of a tensile effect, and due to that tensile effect the body will try to elongate. And that's why the nature of the body is nothing but to retain its original shape. And in order to retain its original shape, the body will generate the internal resistance in the opposite direction of the externally applied load. The externally applied load is tensile nature, and that's why the internal resistance will be compressive of nature. And that's why, as you can see, the internal resistance is shown at the A and B point. And now we want to elaborate that a little bit more, and that's why we have considered the half portion of the left hand side portion of the cross section represented like this. Okay, so consider the half portion, and in this particular half portion there is one external force, that is P force, which is applied horizontally left side, and at the cross section the internal resistance forces are in the opposite direction of the external force. So this internal resistance force R at the particular different points of the cross section are represented like this. These forces will cumulatively be having the value or the magnitude equal to the external force. The external force is having the magnitude of P, and that's why the internal resistance at that section will having the magnitude of P. Both the magnitudes are the same, and that's why the body is in a stable condition. Now, under this condition, if we want to define the stress, that the stress is nothing but the internal resistance per area. The area is the cross-section area of the body, and that we have taken like this, and the equation for the particular stress will be sigma equals to P by A. This equation comes from the internal resistance divided by area, and here in this in this case we have taken the internal resistance magnitude as same as the magnitude of the externally applied force, and that's why instead of the internal resistance we can put P value, which is applied force value. Okay, and this is how we define the stress. Next we will define another important term, that is strain. Now what is strain? To understand the strain, consider a body which is fixed at one end and subjected to an externally applied load P on the another end. As you can see, the nature of the force is tensile, and that's why it will try to elongate the body. So the elongated portion is shown like this. This portion will try to increase the length of the body. Initially the length of the body was L. And now, after increment of some amount of the length, the change in length will be dl. which is represented in the diagram. Now, as you can see, the change in length is near, original length was L, and that's why the ratio of change in length per original length will give you the answer of the strain. Strain can be represented by epsilon, and that's why the formula of the strain, epsilon, is nothing but change in length upon original length, and that's why epsilon equals to dL upon L. That is the formula of strain. So these are the basic two parameters which we have discussed at the introduction and the definition while defining the stress. Now, these two parameters can be related using the one very important theorem that is known as a Hooke's law. Hooke's law is nothing but the Hooke's law can be stated like the within the elastic limit, the value of stress is directly proportional to the strain, and that's why sigma is proportional to epsilon. This is our basic statement of the Hooke's law. This Hooke's law will give you different parameters like the change in length equation, and that will be applied in our actual examples. Now consider the equation of the Hooke's law, that is nothing but the sigma is proportional to strain. Now if you put the individual equations of the both the parameters and try to remove the proportionality, then the proportionality can be removed using one constant only. So here we introduce one constant which is known as an elastic constant. It is also known as a Young's modulus or the modulus of elasticity. So the equation will be sigma equals to E into epsilon. Now we will insert individual equations of the sigma and epsilon. So sigma can be written as P by A, which was already explained in the previous portion of this video. So P by A equals to E into epsilon. Instead of epsilon, we can write dL upon L. Now if you simplify the equation and make the subject dL, we can clearly write this above equation as dL equals to P into L upon A into E. Now this dL is nothing but the change in length of the component, and that's why the change in length equals to dL, that is the change in length, that is dL equals to PL upon AE. This is another equation which was derived from the Hooke's law, basic theorems, and this equation holds good only within the elastic condition of the body. So beyond the elastic condition, you cannot apply this kind of a equation. But in our examples, we will be facing the conditions which will be under the elastic zone only. And that's why in examples, whenever you are asked to find the change in length of the body due to the body is subjected to an external force or due to the application of the stresses, then you will utilize this equation of change in length, that is PL upon AE. So this was the basic idea of the stress, definition of stress, equation of stress, and strain and relation between them. Now we will discuss about the units of these quantities. So the unit of the stress is nothing but the Newton per meter square. As you can see, the equation of the stress is nothing but the sigma equals to P by A. So P is the force, and that's why the unit of the force is Newton. A is the area, and that's why the unit of the A is meter square, and that's why you can write the unit of the stress as a Newton per meter square. Instead of a Newton per meter square, in our examples, we can utilize the equation as a Newton per mm square, because in most of the examples, the components will be having their dimension in mm, and that's why we will most probably utilizing the your unit as a Newton per mm square. Another parameter was a strain, and the strain was the ratio of the delta L upon original L. As you can see, the delta L can be represented also in the meter, and original L also is represented by the meter. And that's why the unit of the strain or epsilon is unitless quantity, because it gets cancelled out from the numerator and the denominator, and that's why the epsilon or the strain is a unitless quantity. Now, if you consider the another parameter which was inserted to remove the proportionality in the Hooke's law, that Young's modulus or modulus of elasticity is directly proportional or directly equated to the stress, and epsilon is unitless quantity, and that's why the unit of Young's modulus is nothing but the same as the unit of the stresses. And that's why the Young's modulus units can be represented as a Newton per meter square or Newton per mm square. So this was all about this lecture. In the upcoming lecture, we will discuss about the parameter stress strain diagram and the different points and importance of these points.
Thank you.